And good evening, everyone. Welcome inside the Houston Fieldhouse here on the campus of Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute in the city of Troy and in the heart of New York State's Capital Region. It's time once more for RPI Engineers Hockey right here on ESPN+. This evening, it's game two of the two-game weekend set for Dave Smith's group here in the Capital Region. They started the weekend with a victory 1-0 over LIU last night, and they look to finish the weekend sweep as the Black Knights of the U.S. Military Academy, or Army, are in town tonight to do battle. Alongside the coach, Dan Fretch, and Dan Ball with you here on ESPN+. And coach, I know it's early. I know we're only three games into the season, and this team has not seen competition in the ECAC yet, but the one thing you can say, this Engineers team is 3-0.
Yeah, they are. As far as the games that count, I mean, they've been playing very, very well. And, you know, they've won it in different ways. They've won games by a couple of goals. They've won games by one goal. So they know they can win those real tight defensive battles.
We may see that today indeed. The Engineers, led by Dave Smith in his sixth season, a record of 54, 88, and 12. On the other side, it's Brian Riley in his 19th season as the head coach here at Army, his record 229, 310, and 89. In net tonight for the Engineers, no surprise, it's Jack Watson, the sophomore out of Toronto, Ontario, in three games, a perfect record 3-0, a 1.67 goals against average and a 9.48 save percentage. Yesterday for Watson, he had a 23-save shutout against LIU, his first of the season. He will be in net. The second line of John Beaton, Brendan Booty, and Jake Gagnon will start for Dave Smith's group on offense. Max Malinsky and Jack Agnew on defense. On the other side, Brian Riley goes with his sophomore net or junior netminder, Gavin Abrick, out of Hayward, Wisconsin, in the New Jersey Hitmen program in the NCDC this year. 0-2-1, a 2.64 goals against average, a 9.08 save percentage. The second line of Michael Sacco, Jake Felker, and Max Itagaki up front with Anthony Furiolo and Noah Wilson on defense. Face off to the right of Jack Watson following the icing, sees Smolinski with possession. Booty chips ahead to Beaton, who started the breakout. He gains the center line. Chips it back behind the goal, a centering feed, no one home except for Smolinski. Picks it up and shoots. He missed the net wide. Long rebound will carry him all the way into the defensive end where Agnew will have to go back and get it. Just 30 seconds in and a turnover in front. Looking for an opportunity, there was John Kieranen. He wasn't able to corral that loose puck. It jumps along and it's shot towards the net there by Farrell, but that got blocked. Ripped past the near side post there, bunted down by Heidemann. Smolinski for Heidemann on the far side. He'll send a pass to the middle. First one unsuccessful, but the second one a bit more so. Jacob Lee tried to move through the legs of Driscoll. That was unsuccessful. A couple changes in the lineup for Dave Smith tonight. TJ Walsh moves up to this top line with Lee and Heidemann, with Ryan Mashey out of the lineup. He came up a little bit lame on a hit in last night's game. No official word on his current status, but he's not in the lineup. James McIsaac, Reed Liebold both check in. Ari Schreifels will sit in today's game as we have a stoppage that'll be called an icing in just under a minute and a half in. The faceoff will head back into the D zone for the Engineers.
And you mentioned the New Jersey Hitmen, a very good coach down there, been with the program a long time, Toby Harris. Did some hockey with him, hockey school with him up at Exeter Hockey School back in the day.
Well, if he comes with the Dan Fridgen seal of approval, then we certainly know that he's made up of the right stuff. A lot of good programs there. You talk about the Jersey Junior Titans program, the Hitmen, which have always been around championships in the NCDC.
Yeah, and they continue to put players into Division I, Division II, Division III college hockey.
Deflected along there by Farrell into the far side corner, giving chase to Joey Doshin, but it's turned over near the line and it's sent ahead. Liebold just out of his reach. He was outstretched trying to poke it along. The other change in the lineup, Nick Ardanaz back in the lineup. Dylan Davies will take a seat here in the second game of the back-to-back. Game four out of four in total this weekend here at the Houston Fieldhouse. We'll have a stoppage of play just over 2 minutes in. A penalty will be called. So we'll see our first man advantage on either side, waiting to get a sense of who the guilty party will be.
Patrick Smith.
It'll be Smith for Army, who will sit for two. So the Engineers will get their first opportunity on the power play.
He took exception of Surdy stepping up on him at the offensive blue line right there. And then you can't see it on camera, but he gave him a little shot with the stick across the chest. And Surdy went down. Patrick went to the box.
The cross check against Smith. The power play last night for the Engineers, 0 for 5. On the season so far, 2 for 7, still clicking at a total of 28.6%. The penalty kill for Army so far this season at 7 for 9, just under 78% so far this year. Last year, an 82.5% mark for Brian Riley's group as Beaton takes it over the center line. Strided in there by Heidemann. He sends it off of the end boards. Hitting an edge there was Farrell for the moment, but it's taken and shoved back out through center, where Laurie Surdy will give chase. He's taken down, and the Engineers will skate 5-on-3. The decision was made there to throw the puck all the way back in deep. They were trying to just get the possession back to Army as quickly as possible to get the stoppage and as much time on the 5-on-3. They'll get a minute and 19. Coach Dan Frisian on the 5-on-3 after another penalty taken in the early going here by Army.
Yeah, that was Karen, and he was trying to get to the puck, but he inadvertently caught the edge of this RPI player. Down he went. Like you say, 5-on-3, so there'll be lots of room to move that puck.
The other of the two units, led by Jacob Lee. Lee wins the draw. Smolinski, left point. Below the goal there for Gagneau. Here is Walsh, back up top for Agnew. Agnew steps in, switches places with Walsh. He has it, down low. Back for Smolinski once more. Goes to the right side. Now Walsh, down low. One-timer there by Gagneau. It got blocked away by Wilson. Here's Smolinski. He shoots, blocker save. Abrick makes the stop on that one. Lee sends it along the board. Smolinski on his backhand will walk the line and walk in, looking for a passing lane. He's got Agnew, the pass too far in front. Gagneau below the goal. Now it's Walsh, back for Gagneau, up top for Agnew. Smolinski, Agnew, one-timer, kicked away by Abrick. 30 seconds to go on the first of the two infractions. Agnew down low, now it's Smolinski. He shoots, that's blocked. Wilson gets in front of that one. Smolinski will try it again, fakes it. Here's Walsh and a save. The best on the sequence for Abrick so far. Agnew off the wall, center point. He walks. Back for Agnew. Blocked in front. Here's Smolinski for Walsh. Now Agnew again. Save made. Rebound and another stop. Still loose in front. Smolinski had a shot at it. Still loose. They score! Countless whacks at the loose puck, ends up on the stick of TJ Walsh. That's a power play goal, and the Engineers strike first.
Well, that was just a great play by the forwards at RPI. They keep shooting the puck. The puck was loose. They didn't give up on it. Army could not find it and cover it, and it comes to the side wide open. TJ Walsh licking his chops and fires it home. And that's a power play goal. And Abrick just couldn't find it.
Walsh the goal at the 4:15 mark here in the first, getting the crowd at the Houston Fieldhouse to their feet. So that will be, if we're being technical about it, which is important to do so, the first penalty had expired. So now we do skate 5-on-5 as Argonauts is back to win the race. So the Engineers went 0-for-1 on the power play just before the goal from Walsh. They do cash in, so a 1-for-2 marker in total after the extended 5-on-3, and that's how we see RPI in the lead.
Well, Abrick was standing in there tall, and he just couldn't handle the barrage of shots that were coming at him.
Walsh's first goal of the season. Second point in total. Last season for Walsh, 4 goals, 19 points. Looking for the second goal of the game there was Brackett on the far side. Skated through center and ahead there by Itagaki. Backhand feed knocked away there by Evans, who was back on the back check. Jake Felker was the intended recipient there on the far side. Evans, a good job as that third player low there on the back check for the Engineers, knocking the puck away. Ardenaz centers for Mazzotti, who brings it into the zone. Now Brackett leaves for a trailer. It's Evans to his backhand, looking in front for Mazzotti. I think he couldn't decide whether or not he wanted to shoot or pass, so he did neither, and instead, Army will skate it out of harm's way. Brought in one versus a few there by Abdelnauer. Sent to the point. Off of the stick, looking for it there was Joey Baez. Top line on the ice here for Brian Riley's group. I wonder how many times I'll do the Brett versus Brian Riley comparison or mistake here this evening. Brett Riley leading the LIU Sharks team that the Engineers saw yesterday. As we have a stoppage, we'll have a penalty here called against the Engineers. It's going to be a hold, and Army will send their power play onto the ice for the first time just over 5 minutes in to period one.
Yeah, it looks like Hallbauer is going to go for the hold.
Kyle Hallbauer, the captain, graduate student out of Howell, New Jersey, took a penalty in yesterday's game to go with a shot on goal and a block. The Engineers took four penalties in the opening 20 minutes yesterday. There were six penalties in total, four for the home team. Dave Smith, though, not too concerned as a shot coming from the far side misses the net. Here's Itagaki, sends it back to the point. Itagaki on the near side, looks back door once more, they score! Joey Baez on the one-timer. Not a ton of heat on it, but a well-placed shot sneaks through Jack Watson. A power play goal on either side has the game tied at one.
Well, that was the second time he teed it up from the back door. The first one missed the net, but he didn't miss on that one. Great setup by, I think that was Karinen making that pass across.
Well, two goals in just under 6 minutes of play here in the first period. We've already gone past our grand total of goals in yesterday night's game. A power play goal on either side. Knocked over the line there by Jacob Lee. He's in a race for the puck, 1v1 into that near corner. He went against Ricky Lyle to try to win it. We didn't get a chance to mention it yesterday. Jacob Lee named the ECAC Player of the Week for his efforts last weekend. 6 points in his first three games. He was held without a shot, so 6 points in two games. Held without a shot in yesterday's contest, but had that incredible start to the season, a five-point night in the Engineers' 6-3 win in game one against Mercyhurst, added another point there on the Saturday contest. He won Player of the Week, and Jack Watson also named Goaltender of the Week. So we apologize for not mentioning the hardware that was won by the Engineers this week for their efforts against Mercyhurst, but still means exactly the same as it did previously. And coach, you know, at any level, it's nice to have your players picking up hardware this early in the season. As Beaton is knocked off the puck, but regains possession, centering feed, they score! Jake Gagnon, top corner over the blocker side of Gavin Abrick, and the Engineers have the lead right back. It's 2-1.
Well, just a great setup by Beaton. John had it along the boards. He did kind of won the battle and put it out to Gagnon, and he was ready and pulled the trigger. Here it is right here. He beat a little back pass right into the space. Gagnon gets there and puts it top shelf on Abrick.
Jake Gagnon's second goal of the season. His season debut was also a multi-point effort last Friday against Mercyhurst. He had a goal and 3 points in total, so adds another goal here on his tally. And RPI, two goals in the first period. They have a 2-1 lead and are looking to add more via Rory Herman, who made the pass for McIsaac on the right side, but he was unable to reconnect with Herman through the middle. Hallbauer was able to knock it out of the zone, so when Army rather regained possession, they did so offsides. So Gagnon on the board to regain the lead for RPI here in the early going. Three goals in just under 8 minutes of work, the first five-on-five or even strength goal that either side has seen. Evans and Mazzotti A-frame against the wall, but Army's able to take possession back. Klee bunts it off of the end boards, allowing Nick Strom to send it up to the line. Evans will do the rest, finding Mazzotti skating in along the near side. Mazzotti was looking back door. Jack Brackett was tied up there by Gilbert as the two were going towards the net at the same time. Brackett knocked it around the boards, was looking for Mazzotti. Strom is able to step in, and then Evans is the one who keeps it in at the line. Mazzotti steals, thanks in part to the pressure by Brackett. He's trying to lose Gilbert with a couple of quick moves on his edges. Brackett sends along the board. Strom steps in from the point. The engineer is switching possession from side to side, trying to open up a little bit of room in the offensive end. Eventually, it's taken out of harm's way by Karanen, allowing Baez to skate into the zone. Goes through his legs on the far side, but he's met there by Klee with the body. Puck knocked out. Here's Driscoll stepping in, was looking for a backdoor pass. Did not connect. Now here's Heidemann in the zone on the right side. He'll try to drop the shoulder, decide against it, and stop. Agnew knocks it to the net, puck loose in front. No one able to find it in the white sweater. It was cleared out of harm's way, but right into the care of the defenseman for the Engineers, Nick Ardanaz. Lee taps it backwards. Ardanaz finds Lee once more, and an O from the crowd as Ardanaz put it through a defender's leg in order to do so. The move that's called the nutmeg in the soccer world, in case anybody was wondering. I'm sure a lot of people were. Driscoll met by two white sweaters. It's knocked up and out of play, and a stoppage with 10:41 to go. Shots on goal in the early going, unofficially, on the scoreboard here at the Houston Fieldhouse. 9-1 in favor of the Engineers of RPI. Army will go for a change. Here getting a read of the situation, so RPI will have one more opportunity to do so. Dave Smith is wondering, okay, so why are we allowing them to change? After all of the discussion, it ends up that the puck was deflected off of an RPI player last. So the faceoff back to the neutral zone. It's won by Michael Sacco. Pass too far ahead for Felker. Watson will go back and stop it behind his net. Feeling the pressure there was Ardanaz. A turnover in front. Felker on goal. That's blocked. Into the corner, allowing Ardanaz to send it off the glass and all the way down. It was too far ahead of anyone. Noah Wilson will win the race. That will be icing against RPI. And the faceoff will head back into the defensive zone.
Just looking at the lineup here for Army and speaking to Coach Riley before the game. He's got 17 freshmen and sophomores in the lineup. Well, excuse me, in the program, not necessarily in the lineup, but he's got 17 of them. That's a lot. So he's going to have a lot of patience this year. And that's the third youngest NCAA Division I hockey team in the nation.
Quite amazing. And, you know, you look up and down their stat sheet from a year ago, and it's player who isn't in the program anymore after player who isn't in the program anymore is beaten, whips it on goal, the save made there by Abrick. So it's tough to get anything going in the early going when you know that you're essentially starting a lot of your program from scratch. But again, if you hit on more recruits than you do not, you can really kind of build a foundation with that young group. You can establish that culture that we talk about so frequently, but that takes time. It takes patience and a good coaching staff to do it well.
Exactly. And he can lose players to the transfer portal.
Right.
However, he doesn't bring players in from the transfer portal because you can't transfer credits in. You have to start off as a plebe. I can't see many graduate players doing that.
Nor can I. It would be quite the pivot. It'd be a very honorable pivot to make, but you definitely wouldn't see it very often. So whatever you recruit is yours and yours alone. Shot on goal, in and out of the catching glove there by Watson. The player that you saw coming into your screen was Joey Doshin. Sent from the point, deflected just wide. Doshin standing at 6'6" on offense. So if we ever see a Doshin versus Mazzotti collision anywhere on the ice, it's going to be quite the spectacle to see. Herman fights his way through a couple of defenders, knocked to the ice in the process. All hands of the officials remain by their side, so we'll continue to go. Good physical play there by Herman as it's advanced ahead, sent on goal. A glove save made as Lucas Canta took the shot. Watson will hang on. With 8:43 to go in period number one, 2-1, Engineers over the Army Black Knights in the early going. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN+.
Hi, I'm Andy James at Rensselaer Honda, and this is my buddy Bo. Looking to sell your car or truck? We want to buy it. Are you looking for a great used car? We have a huge selection. That's why Rensselaer Honda has been your Honda dealer for 44 years.
RPI Hockey is back. Contact the Houston Fieldhouse box office at 518-276-6262 or boxoffice@rpi.edu to watch your Engineers in action this season.
For the love of the game, the team, or for two, Recovery Sports Grill. At Recovery Sports Grill, you'll always have courtside seats to exciting live sports coverage. And for outstanding loyalty perks, join our Hall of Fame, Recovery Sports Grill, serving up smiles every season.
.843 to go, opening period here in Troy, a 2-1 lead for the homestanding Engineers of RPI over the visiting Army Black Knights. Army 0-2-1 on the season to this point. They opened up against a team from the Capital Region. They were at home facing off against Union back on October 2nd, a game that ended in a 2-2 tie. They then went out and battled RIT, Rochester Institute of Technology, last weekend on the 7th and the 8th. Two hard-fought losses, 3-2 and 4-1. Leading Brian Riley's group to the 0-2-1 record that they see in the early going. So again, we talk about the youth, and you look at an 0-2-1 record, and you say, all right, they're building, they're still in the early stages. So you can't be too worried about that when we're in the middle of October and you haven't started league play yet, you'd have to imagine.
No question. I mean, it's good to have a good start, but it's real early in the season, and as you all know, the season is full of peaks and valleys, and it's how you handle that adversity as a team which will determine where you ultimately end up in the standings.
Here is Lee over the line, sent on goal by Heidemann, deflected wide. Hitting the brakes, though, is Lee. He's Johnny on the spot there to find that loose puck. Loose in front, and Lee caught a collision up high. He's going to head to the bench. It looked like he caught either a stick or a shoulder up in the mask area, so he will go to the bench and get a look. Shaking it off a little bit. He's going to stay on the bench for the time being, but you could see him give the quick shake of the head, shaking the cobwebs, so to speak. Just what seemed like an innocuous play, but he had a lot of players coming back at him as he was trying to make that play there in the slot. Stepping away and stepping in, looking for a backdoor feed there was Itagaki, but it was deflected behind the goal. He's on it once more, and a hit laid there by Gagneau, getting a cheer from the crowd. Beaten at the line, has it knocked away. Delayed offsides will be whistled down. We'll have a stoppage. The faceoff will go back into the neutral zone. What did you see on that hit there from Lee a few moments ago?
I don't know if it was him colliding with one of the Army players or his own player, but I think it might have caught him in the chin. But happens more often than not during the course of a hockey game.
Mazzotti wins the draw clean back to Ardenaz, who is one of the two defenders alongside Mason Klee out there right now. Brackett pursuing Wilson, who's able to step away and backhand a feed out to the neutral zone. A penalty coming up. It's going to be against RPI. It's going to be against Mazzotti, who is exchanging a couple of words with Wilson after a big hit laid there behind the play on Joey Baez. So Mazzotti will sit for two on the hit behind the play.
It's going to be two for boarding as opposed to a hit from behind.
You could see on the replay there as the puck was going by, there was some room between Baez and the board. So you saw the collision. And of course, you know, Mazzotti at 6'6", he's going to create a collision with just about anyone,
especially with Baez at 5'9",
giving up a few inches to say the least. So the discussion right now possibly about the 2 minutes versus any other call, as Brian Riley is making sure he gets his money's worth before the puck is dropped. Power play back on the ice for the Black Knights of Army. They are 1-for-2 so far this evening. Puck is down. Kieranen on the draw. It's controlled by Army here on the far side. That's Baez. Pass was deflected, goes up and into the stands, so they'll do it again. But you can see, Coach, there's a commitment early on. They want to try to spread the puck around in the offensive zone and really use as much of the either side as they can to try to open up the offense a little bit.
Yeah, they got one-time guys sitting on the flanks, so they're trying to go through the seams, and how you do that, you get the puck moving around the perimeter and you got the defense moving. They have to make sure that they're leading with their sticks going through the diamond. Oh, excuse me, the box.
Gagneau rips it the length of the rink, so keep an eye on the formation there and the active use of the stick there by the defenders of the Engineers to try to break up those passes. Delayed offside will allow the Engineers to get a free breakout. Pass towards Itagaki in the middle. He's met by Evans, so he has to hit the brakes. Finds a bit more room for himself. Leaves off for a man coming. That's Baez. Ferriolo off the wall for Itagaki. Now down low. To the point, Ferriolo, who walks the line right over the ECAC hockey logo here at the Houston Fieldhouse. A pass is deflected into the corner. A minute gone by in the penalty against Mazzotti. Centering feed, kick, save, rebound loose for Baez to the backhand. And a pass in front, kicked away by Watson, kept in at the line there by Ferriolo. Pass to the backhand of the defender, stepping in. Now is Ferriolo once more. The puck floats in on Watson, and he'll glove it down and get a stoppage of play.
You know, I was curious, before the game started, looking at the lineup, seeing Max Itagaki at 5'7", 155, and I'm like, whoa. That's kind of on the small side. And then you see him out there. Oh, he's got a little bit of shake and bake his game.
What he doesn't necessarily have in vertical skill, he definitely has in the horizontal variety. He had an assist and a couple shots against RIT in game number one. That was his first career point. Sent below the goal, trying to find it there was Sacco. Second unit on the ice here for Brian Riley's group as we're now down to 27 seconds to go on the penalty shot by Driscoll. That skitters its way past the post, knocked loose. Mason Klee on his backhand. Couldn't get it past the man who was marking him, Reese Farrell. Sacco tried to advance it in front once more. Didn't work. Poked away from Driscoll and over the line where Farrell will have to go back and grab it. Now 7 seconds to go on the penalty. Mazzotti about to exit the box. Farrell takes it below the goal. The call from the crowd tells us that the penalty is over. Not only that, but the Engineers are able to knock it out of the zone in quick order, and the rest of their killers will go for a change.
I'm impressed with our Army's power play. They move the puck around well. They're getting some good looks.
For a team that has scored just 5 goals in their first 3 games coming into tonight, that's an average of under 2. That's 47th in the nation. They do definitely move the puck around, and again, the ability to move the puck doesn't necessarily always correlate into scoring. A big hit laid down low there by Heidemann, who was in on that. Deflected on goal, saved by Watson, and a hit laid in return there by Smolinski. A couple of big players on the ice there, that's Smith and Doshin. Sent to the point, Kempton, sent on goal, deflected wide. Andrew Gilbert, the one who took the shot from the left point. Smolinski picks off a pass in the middle. Gilbert keeps it in, pops it up in the air. A high stick is ruled against RPI. So we'll have a stoppage of play. The faceoff will remain in the defensive end. 4:15 to go, first period, 2-1 RPI over Army. So the two players that were in on the forecheck, 25 and 26, Patrick Smith, 6'4", 215, Joey Doshin, 6'6", 220.
What does the referee want to talk to him about?
Well, we have 1, 2, and 3 of the officials. Something possibly being reviewed here, Coach?
Yes. It looks that way.
The officials in tonight's game, well, we have a moment to pause. Anthony DiPuzzo and Chris Pistocia the two referees, Dan Taggart, Brendan Wormley, the linesman. So as you can see on the top right side of your screen, there's an official review for what I'm not necessarily sure. Maybe who touched the puck last?
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking, whether or not it was. I thought it was the Army player that had the high stick as opposed to the RPI player. Maybe that's what they're trying to get right.
Well, we have a moment to pause. 4:15 remaining period number one. Give you a quick update on the scoring while we have a moment to sit down and catch our breath. But before that, Coach, a look at the previous play. See if we can get an idea of, well, what exactly happened here.
Well, that was an Army player that hit it. That's what I thought.
It's either he or Smolinski. We'll take another look at it. So Smolinski clears. Gilbert is the one who kind of chops it up in the air. I don't know.
Ooh, is that?
See, I watched it the last time and I thought it was Smolinski, which is probably why they're taking a look at it. And it appears
that's going to be the guy with the white stick. Yeah, it is. It's Smolinski. You're right.
Yep. All right.
It's the guy with the white stick.
Point Dan Ball in the early going. Face off to the left of Jack Watson. Lee will lean in opposite John Kiernan, won by Kiernan in the Black Knights. Shot coming from the point was blocked. One timer blocked as well. That was Baez getting blocked by Agnew. And a very nice one there by the Engineers defender, knocked out to the neutral zone. Ferriolo will send a pass to Kiernan, who will do the rest of the work.
That was a great block by Agnew. That puck was right in the slot area.
Engineers have not been afraid to lay the body here. It's, you can kind of see the effects of playing a physical team like LIU the night before. RPI has been quick to lay the body. Kiernan has it. Left side to the point. One timer blocked. Whipped on goal from the point. That shot coming from Noah Wilson. It went wide. The block was TJ Walsh, who was able to get a body on that one. The Engineers are very much pinned in their own ends following the defensive zone start. Walsh pops it out to the neutral zone, bunted down there by Heidemann, but it was played with a stick above the shoulder, so he'll have to cede possession back to Wilson in the Knights. At the line, knocked away. Good stick on defense there by Heidemann. That ends the possession for Army, allows them to change, but it also allows RPI to gain the line and send the puck the rest of the way. Doing the work there was Laurie Surdy, who scored the one and only goal yesterday. Again, they're all snipes in the book as that one's sent in on Abrick. He makes the stop. A battle in the near corner. Surdy took the puck up on the offensive rush. Gagneau steals. Centers and a save made by Abrick. The rebound skitters to the far side corner where Gagneau knocks it free. Beaton will attempt to win the race to the puck. Sent to the point, kept in by Surdy. To the line and not out once more. So two for two, the Finnish defender finding booty. He shoots, blocked. Into the corner once more. Beaton sends it to the point. Surdy for Hallbauer. He'll send it into the corner, not having a shooting lane or a passing lane that he was looking for. So why not keep it safe? And that's exactly what he does.
That pressure by RPI here is all started off with a turnover with the D-man thinking he's going to run a reverse. They give it right to the RPI player below the goal line.
There was a turnover just a few moments ago. Surdy will head to the bench. Evans is able to steal. Here's Mazzotti below the goal. Sent in front there, was looking for Brackett, but the puck didn't quite reach where he was looking for in front of the net. Brackett shoots, blocked wide. Evans in on the forecheck, trying to knock it away. It is knocked away successfully. Puck now for Itagaki near the line. He's able to chip it around Hallbauer, but only as far as center. Mazzotti for Klee, who will lead the rush. Klee into the zone, near side Mazzotti. Into the corner where he's met by Farrell. Knocked for Evans. He was trying to work it to the point. Instead, Mazzotti was there to help him. Three black sweaters in trying to take the puck away. One was successful. And now it's Farrell in the corner, chipped all the way out to the center line, but gloved down by Klee. He gains the line, takes a hit, but ends up getting the better of the exchange as he and Noah Wilson ran into one another. Ardenas quickly up for Herman. Final minute of play here in what has been a very exciting first period of action as McIsaac leaves for Herman. Tried to whip it on goal quickly. He could not. Here is Liebold in the corner, reversing for Herman. Herman and Liebold do battle in the near corner. Sent to the point, Ardanaz goes cross for Smolinski, who will have to just knock it in deep. Down to 30 seconds to go in period one. Ardanaz steps in from the point, kept in at the line there by McIsaac. A backhand will deflect off of Ricky Lyle and into the corner. Army really unable to escape their own end, as getting back up just in time there was Herman. RPI in the midst of a change. Herman was looking for Ardanaz. A clearing attempt is off of the body of the freshman defender who was in there forechecking. 10 seconds to go. Army will try it once more. This time they knock it out to center. Smolinski takes a big hit. 5 seconds to go. Walsh will try for one more chance. Here's Lee on goal. Save Abrick, and the rebound will be controlled by Abdelnauer as the clock hits triple zeros here from period number one. 2-1. The Engineers leading the Black Knights of Army. And before we step aside here after 20 minutes of play, Coach, take us through the three goals that we saw on both sides to get us the score we have after 20.
Well, the first one starts off with TJ Walsh on the power play, 5-on-3. You can't see, there's the Army player coming out of the box. It goes right to Walsh, and he puts it behind Abrick for 1-0.
Another look at that one. You see it's all started with good puck movement there in the umbrella formation. It ends up with 2, 3, 4, 7, 12 whacks at it before eventually TJ Walsh pots his first goal of the season. But it wasn't long, Coach, before Army was able to get back in this one. Another look here, seeing the setup for the Engineers on their 5-on-3. Then it was very briefly a 5-on-4 power play. Another look. Somehow Smolinski wasn't able to score, but Walsh made sure that somebody did. So that was the 1-0 goal, and then Army was able to tie it on their own power play.
Well, this is the one that came across for great setup by Tadagaki. I butchered that one. He goes right across, and just a great one-timer by Baez.
Bit of a no-look pass there as well. You could see his eyes still were on the netminder Watson. Another look here on the near side. On the strong side there was Zitagaki, so you can see that he's a guy that's going to be setting up plays, and Brian Riley hopes that it's for years to come. But RPI was able to grab the lead right back here, Coach.
Yes, another great play. That's a nice pass by Beaton out to Gagnon, and it's in the net. Quick release.
Right over the blocker of Gavin Abrick. That's how the RPI Engineers took their 2-1 lead, and that is where we sit after 20 minutes of play. Shots on goal in the first period, 10-6 in favor of the homestanding Engineers, and that's how they hold their 2-1 lead. The coach and I will step aside. We'll be back with the second period in just a few moments. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN+.
are boundary-pushing change agents. We do what it takes to make things happen together. It's our collaborative spirit that sparks creativity and pushes us to think beyond ourselves. We're scrappy and unabashedly enthusiastic about our passions and projects. We are hardwired for the havoc of change. We know it isn't easy, that theories can fail and world changing can feel futile. But that's the calm before the brilliant storm. The breath you take before you break through. Small change comes from asking why. Changing the world comes from asking, why not? That's the question we ask everyone, from freshmen to faculty. It's the question that fuels us to find the next new. The question we ask you, why not change the world?
It's the most historic conference in college hockey. It's a battle night in and night out. ECAC hockey, an iconic conference home to 12 of the most prestigious universities and programs in the world, and showcasing the best student athletes in the sport. Top-notch facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions. ECAC hockey, there's no experience like it.
For the love of the game, the team, or for two, Recovery Sports Grill. At Recovery Sports Grill, you'll always have courtside seats to exciting live sports coverage. And for outstanding loyalty perks, join our Hall of Fame, Recovery Sports Grill, serving up smiles every season.
RPI Hockey is back. Contact the Houston Fieldhouse box office at 518-276-6262 or boxoffice@rpi.edu to watch your Engineers in action this season.
Hi, I'm Andy James at Rental Honda, and this is my buddy Bo. Looking to sell your car or truck? We want to buy it. Are you looking for a great used car? We have a huge selection. That's why Rental Honda has been your Honda dealer for 44 years.
.7:30 to go, middle period here at the Houston Fieldhouse. 3-1 Engineers over the Black Knights of Army, sprayed out of the zone. And a delayed offsides call will be whistled down by the linesman Taggart. Moving the faceoff from the defensive end into the neutral zone. If you're just joining us, the one goal here in period two coming from John Evans, his first career goal at 5:31. Jack Brackett, the primary and so far only assist awarded on the goal from Evans. He picked a corner over the blocker of Gavin Abrick. That extended the lead for RPI. They got out to a 1-0 lead, took the 2-1 lead back, and now have the insurance marker. And that's how we have a 3-1 game thus far. He's Dan Fridgen. I'm Dan Ball. We're on ESPN Plus, and we thank you for joining us. Been a busy weekend of hockey, to say the least, here in Troy. Game 4 out of 4 of our broadcast this weekend as Booty sends on goal, deflected wide there by Beaton. Three white sweaters are below the goal trying to find that puck. It was the other color, John Driscoll, in the black jersey, who was able to find it. Long pass ahead is deflected in there by Huss to avoid the icing. Eric Huss, the 13th forward in the lineup for Brian Riley's group this evening. Heidemann on the near side, ahead for Lee. He takes it over the line. Into the corner he goes, marked by Gilbert. Heidemann sends to the point, kept in by Hallbauer. He sends intentionally wide, but it was gloved down before it got to that point. Ricky Lyle was able to take it down. And Lyle is the one who sends it the length, and then he took a hit from the glove area of Austin Heidemann. That's what we'll call it, and that's what we'll leave it with. RPI not shying away from the physical game here in this one, Coach.
Not at all. I mean, that's what you have to do against this Army team. Wear them down.
Heidemann a pass into space looking for Lee. Eventually, Brackett does find it. He's got a man in front. He was looking for Evans, who was looking for his second consecutive goal. And Hallbauer was looking to lay the boom there on Garby if he got the chance, but Garby didn't collect the puck. So he realized, no, can't do that. I would have been sitting for two. He'll instead lead the breakout and take it through the neutral zone to the center line and in. Here is Brackett on goal. Had a little bit of heat on it, was looking either for the shot or the pass. Mazzotti goes the other way for Hallbauer, who was kind of in that one-timer spot for the time being. Taking it out of the zone into center, but the pass would not connect. The pass came from Abdelnauer. He was looking for his captain, Firiolo, but was unable to connect. Banked off the boards there by Ardenaz, forcing Army to regroup once more. Deflected in by Abdelnauer into the corner. Ardenaz's pass is stolen, nearly taken in front. An opportunity to get a shot by the wayside, and now RPI brings it back the other way. It's Mazzotti finding the trailer, deflected in front, and a shot on the backhand there by Ardenaz, who was in on the offense, was turned aside. To the line, Evans knocks a man over. Partial 2-on-1 with a couple trailers coming. A pass in front to the backhand, and the shot wouldn't go. A penalty upcoming. The shot coming from Karinen. He tried to go forehand to backhand on Watson. He did the first part, but the second part wouldn't sit for him. But a penalty upcoming in the process.
He had him too. He just lost the puck at the last second. Watson sticking his leg out. He had the far side, but real nice play for number 23, Baez, to get that puck over to him.
Karinen wasn't able to score, but he did draw a penalty. It'll go against Sutter Mazzotti. He'll sit for two for hooking at the 15:32 mark. So the power play back on the ice for Army, 1-for-2 so far. To the center point. Shot coming from the far side, save made by Watson. Played on the far side to the point.
Sorry, I was going to say, I was just thinking that RPI had been activating their D quite a bit to get caught in 2-on-1.
Very much so, as Herman will skate it up and then back, killing a bit of time before flipping it the rest of the way. Beaton, fresh off the bench, will go in on the forecheck there against Farrell. And you're right, you know, we've seen a lot of 3-on-2s and 3-on-3s that could have been just that, but we've seen Nick Ardenaz jump in on the offense. We've seen Nick Strom jump in on those rushes as well. Even Kyle Hallbauer was up below the top of the faceoff circles for a while, a shift or two ago. So it's a strategy, and it really does help the offense if you know you have your defenders in on it. Speaking of, here's Itagaki's shot. That's turned aside by Watson. Rebound to the line, but kept in. Played on the near side there by Baez. Pulled off the wall by Firiolo. Itagaki back to the point. Furiolo. Here's Bios, who scored a power play goal earlier. Sends it towards the net, deflected wide. Adlenauer met by two white sweaters, but it's knocked free for the moment. On the backhand there is Karanen. Itagaki to the point. Furiolo walks in and shoots one. That's blocked. Beaten, fouled, and McIsaac does the rest of the work, sending it the rest of the way. A minute and a half gone by on the penalty against Mazzotti.
Yeah, Itagaki's pretty clever on that flank for Army. He's not a one-time shooter. He's just looking to dish and set things up.
Good defense there by the Engineers, led by Evans near their defensive blue line, forces a regroup of black and gold sweaters with just a bit of white trim. And one thing you'll notice on these jerseys, no last name plates. This one sent all the way down on Abrick, who will steer it to the far side boards. Feeling the footsteps, though, as Furiolo nearly turns it over. Now he does to Lee. Lee to the point. Here's Agnew. Fakes it. Takes it. Kick save. Rebound. Score! TJ Walsh on the doorstep. His second goal of the game. It's 4-1 RPI.
Well, it was just at the end of the power play for Army. And a real good job. Faking the shot was Agnew. And then Walsh is sitting there on the doorstep on his forehand. But that play was made down low. When they got it back to the point, Agnew double pump. Fake it here. Rebound. Tough one for Abrick to get that one back.
I tell you what I noticed too, there were two white sweaters between the last defender, whoever it was, and the goalie, which is never a sign for success on defense. The goal coming from Walsh. Agnew the primary assist. Jacob Lee will grab a secondary as he fed the puck to Agnew on the point. A win of a forecheck battle causing a turnover, a shot from the point, a defenseman activating to do so, and a rebound collected by Walsh.
That's about
as good as it gets.
Sorry.
No, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say that's who I was trying to think of, Jacob Lee, that brought the puck down low and threw it back to Agnew.
It happens so quickly, it goes by in the blink of an eye, and just like that, RPI up by a three spot. The largest lead they've had since midway through the first game of the regular season against Mercyhurst. Army is going to get a chance, though, on the power play in a few moments. It'll be Ardenas, I believe, who will get the penalty. Extra tacker on as Abrick goes to the bench. Taken back out into the neutral zone by Driscoll, so the Black Knights are going to try to take a page out of the Engineers' book and get some extra time here on the 6-on-5. Looking for a backdoor pass. That pass coming from Sacco, looking backdoor for Lyle. Sacco once more. Up top, one-timer turned aside. Not sure if it got all the way to the net, but Brendan Booty will touch it up along the near side boards. We do have under a minute remaining here in period two. The remaining 40 seconds, assuming that Army is unable to score, will be spent on the power play, as Nick Ardenas will sit for two for a trip.
Army just couldn't maintain that puck possession like RPI did there earlier in the period.
Well, the bar was set so high.
Yeah,
you know,
it was almost 2 minutes.
When you get a full 6-on-5 power play, and then the whistle blows, and then you get another 5-on-4 power play, it's quite the feat. Not to mention quite the arm workout for the official that had the gall to make the call. Faceoff won by Army, their power play back on the ice. To the point, Furiolo, top unit on here for Brian Riley's group. It's Itagaki, he shoots, that's blocked. Hallbauer will one-hand it out to center. A nice one-man show there by Kyle Hallbauer to block the shot and clear it, forcing Army to regroup. That pass coming from Karanen to Baez remained onside, impressively so. Karanen for Itagaki. Back for Karanen, top of the circle, looking to avoid a couple of sticks. A battle ensues, 4 seconds and three, knock loose and clear the rest of the way. A successful first minute, or 40 seconds at least, of penalty kill time. The Engineers will be back on the man disadvantage for the third period. But that likely won't matter very much, at least at the beginning. The Engineers, a 4-1 lead after 40 minutes of play. You get the lead, then you add on to the lead. That's exactly what you like to see. And, Coach, here's how they did it.
Well, there's Evans with his shot with the look-off pass to Beaton. Beaton would have been quacking there because he's using him as a decoy.
Okay. There's the decoy. There's the shot. There's the goal, the first of the career for John Evans. That made it 3-1. This made it 4-1.
Yeah, just a shot, simple play, shot on goal. Rebound right to Walsh, and he finishes the play.
All starts with the forecheck of Jacob Lee, the shot from Agnew, and the goal for Walsh, his second of the game. That made it 4-1, and that is where we stand at the 40-minute mark of play. So an exciting third period to wrap up the weekend coming up here in Troy. Shots on goal, 24-9 in favor of the Engineers. The score also in favor of the Engineers. 4-1 the score after two. Dan Friggin and I will be back with more after this. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN+.
Thank you. RIP next weekend. Come on out to Houston Fieldhouse. Support your RPI women's hockey team. Pop drops at 3 p.m. both Friday and Saturday.
Warm on up Spirit Shop. From hot coffee to soup, hot entrees, and cheeseburgers. Spirit Shop is a great place for a quick bite that will warm you up each time for your previous this time of year. You'll find more choices in real fast food restaurants, or some delicious meatballs, the crispy chicken sandwich, chicken tenders, and the Alice combination with new caramel hot dogs with free meatballs. Door in and back on the road in no time with a hearty meal that will keep you going all day. Warm on up Spirit Shop.
It's the most historic conference in college hockey. It's about 100 in and 100 out. BCFC Hockey, an iconic conference home, controlled by the most prestigious university in the world, and showcasing the best team athletes in the sport. High-end facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, and alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions.
In NCAA football action this afternoon, final score of ACAB Stadium, RPI 16, Hobart 13.
Two periods down and one to go from the Houston Fieldhouse here in the city of Troy on the campus of RPI. The score after 40 minutes of play in this one, the homestanding Engineers of RPI holding a 4-1 advantage over the Army Black Knights as we head into the final period of regulation. What has been a very busy weekend of hockey here in the Capital Region. Alongside the coach, Dan Pridgen, I'm Dan Ball here on ESPN Plus. Thanks so much for joining us tonight and all weekend long. And coach, as we close in on the final period of play here in regulation, a lot to like for the Engineers through 40 minutes of play. What do you need to see in the game's final 20?
You know what? I think they just need to keep up the consistency and keep up their performance. I think they're playing very well as a team. Everybody's contributing, and you know, that's what you look for, and that's what you need in order to be successful at this level.
The Engineers held a 2-1 lead after one period of play. They added on to that with two goals of their own. John Evans scoring at 5:31. Jack Brackett, the lone assist on that one. First career goal for Evans. That made it 3-1, and then TJ Wall scored his second goal of the game and of the season at just before the 18-minute mark from Jack Agnew and Jacob Lee. It's 4-1, and that is where we stand. Jack Watson back in the crease to our right. He's made 8 saves on the 9 shots he's faced. Hasn't been overly busy, especially last period when there were just 2 shots on net from Army. Gavin Abrick back in the net now to our left. So far tonight, is 20 of 24. The Engineers in their white jerseys skating from right to left across your screen here in the third and final period of regulation. There are 53 seconds remaining on the penalty that was assessed to Nick Ardenas in the second period's final moments as this one sprayed the rest of the way down. The power play currently sitting at 1-for-3 for Army. They scored on their second opportunity of the evening. So we'll see if they go to 2-for-4 or 1-for-4. That's what's at stake. Sent to the point, kept in by Firiolo, walking the lane and shooting. He scores. Well, that answers that question pretty quickly. A possible deflection in front. Looks like it went off of Brett Abdelnauer on its way to the net and behind Watson. A power play goal 55 seconds into the third. And Army has cut the lead in half. It's 4-2.
Well, just a real nice shot. I don't know if Abdelnauer, you know what? It looks like Abdelnauer got that and deflected it up top shelf. Take another look at it here. He gets in front of Watson. Couldn't really tell, but I think he might have got a stick on it.
If you go by who was leading the celebration line, Abdelnauer will get credit for the goal. That's a power play mark, the second of the night for Army. So the lead for the Engineers cut back down to two. It is now 4-2. If it is given to Abdelnauer, that'll be his second goal of the season and now his fourth game. He scored in game one against RIT last weekend. Also had an assist in that one on two shots on net. Knocked away there by Farrell, a backhander deflected through the crease and into the near corner. Brought the other way by Heidemann. He leads the rush, he has Walsh and finds him. Walsh toe drags, looks to shoot, it's knocked away. And skated back to the center line there by Lyle. He brings it in, looks for a shot, takes it. It's blocked by Agnew into the corner, and he lays a big hit on Lyle in the process. Sneaking in from the point for a shot, knocked away by Walsh. The rebound loose in front still. Taken away by Smolinski and knocked to the far corner. Another couple of chances there for Army to try to get this game back to within a goal. A turnover and another chance. A pass below the goal, a shot, save, rebound, score! Jake Felker goes up and above the blocker of Watson. Two goals in the first 2:23 of period three as Army within a goal.
Well, the RPI didn't hear me when I said they have to play consistent here and continue with their performance. But just a great shot off a rebound. Pretty harmless play, but look how you just shoot it towards the net. You got a defender in behind, you got a forward in behind the defender. Smolinski, and rebound goes up top shelf off the glove and then stick side on Watson.
Unfortunately, not much that the aforementioned Watson can do on that one as this puck will go the length and be an icing against Army. You know, you saw in that replay, and the second view was the best one to see. It's Smolinski and Agnew were the two that were on defense together. They were sitting right around the hash marks, and there was a player that was wide open in front of it. It wasn't the goal scorer, Felker, but you can't necessarily have a player on the other team between your defense and the goalie. That's not going to work very often.
No, similar to what happened in the second period when Walsh got his goal.
Sent off the glass and out to center. That's very true. So fans learning that on both ends of the ice. Sent on goal, swallowed up by Watson. He'll hang on with no rebound. 2.5 minutes gone by. And a game that is now 4-3. Seemed like it was 4-1 just a few moments ago. Quick check of the out-of-town scoreboard. Well, we have a break in the action. End of two periods at RIT. They are doubling up the Union Dutchman 6-3. St. Lawrence leading Colorado College 3-1. Quinnipiac doubling up North Dakota on the road. That is 4-2. And then an exhibition match between Cornell. They are hosting Ottawa. They are winning 4-1 after two. Backdoor pass looking there for Doshin. Didn't connect. Sent to the point. Now Firiolo had a chance to advance it in front. Admittedly, I did not see this, but it's 5-on-5. For some reason, I counted 4. I apologize. That was just the announcement of the goal. I tell you, it's period 12 out of 12 this weekend, and I think I'm starting to see multiple players. So I'll just focus on the white sweater in the middle of the three that I'm seeing. Same thing for the visitors. That is Doshin to the line. Only as far as Kanta, who had to stop and will start it again. It's sprayed into the near corner.
close one eye. Sometimes helps me.
I'll just treat it like an eye test at the optometrist. Read the numbers on the line. That'll be easy. To the center line, knife down there by Farrell. Nice job there. Lyle skated it over the line, but Farrell was too far ahead of him. He tried to drag that line. Could not do so successfully. The play is offsides.
Well, if it's anything, last year down at Tate when RPI was playing at Army, they had 2-0 lead, and they had a 3-1 lead and ended up tying the game 3-3.
A very interesting, so far, coincidence. We'll see how the rest plays out based on that. A pass from Evans was meant for Brackett, but it was knocked away. Pass will go past Lori Surdy and the length of the rink, but will be waved off, the ruling that Surdy could have played that puck. He and Kyle Hallbauer are on defense together. Deflected in front, kick save. Watson, rebound loose behind the net. Two or three whacks at that rebound, but Watson was able to keep it away before Surdy got there to the rescue. Hallbauer was taken down with a stick, and he's going to draw a penalty. A very important call made there in the offensive end for Army. They take a penalty with the momentum on their side, so RPI gets a break, and they get a power play out of it as well.
Yeah, that was Felker working real hard. I mean, they've got RPI on their heels a little bit. And again, a couple of the forwards getting in behind the RPI defense, getting opportunities with just Jack Watson there on the rebound.
Fourth power play of the evening for the Engineers. They are 1-for-3. The power play marker, the first of the game for them in this one. It was TJ Walsh scoring on what had just finished up being a 5-on-3 advantage. It was technically a 5-on-4 power play mark. Knocked to the line, kept in there by Agnew. He walks in, goes back door. Gagneau shot that blocked. Another chance knocked away. Karenin will clear it all the way down. A couple of chances for Gagneau on the back door there.
Yeah, he set up real nice. He's got a good shot. Army, as usual, coming out in the shooting lane and blocking those shots.
Gagneau scored the second goal of the game just about a minute after the game-tying goal was scored by Baez. All this coming back in period one. Agnew sends below the goal. Here is Walsh looking for a lane. Pass fluttered on him a bit, but Agnew keeps it in. Now it's Smolinski. Steps in, looking for a lane to shoot. He has one, and he scores! Max Smolinski with a rocket! The insurance is restored for RPI. It's 5-3 Engineers. That's a power play goal.
Well, it looked like at one point he was going to go down low to Jacob Lee, but it was closed off by one of the Army penalty killers, so he decides to just rifle it, and it goes top shelf on the goaltender for Army, who really couldn't see it. He had a lot of traffic in front of him. Abrick not able to come up with the save.
Grab that puck for Max Smolinski, the freshman out of Bloomfield Hills, Michigan, his first career goal. A huge insurance marker on the power play for the Engineers, who get their second power play goal in four tries so far.
And a costly penalty where you're just working hard and unfortunately you get the stick up too high and pull down the defender.
That's a very good point too, especially when you consider the momentum as another Engineers player taken down. That was Harmon, who was trying to escape the zone and had a member of the Knights draped atop him. Here is McIsaac on the right. He'll try to flutter one on goal. It gets blocked. Hallbauer in on the offense. He's all the way behind the red line, trying to shake a defender. Hallbauer protects. He's taken down, and he'll draw a penalty again. Andrew Garby was the one who took him to the ice. Watson will head to the bench. He won't make it all the way there. The captain, Kyle Hallbauer, has been active all over the ice in this third period. He's just drawn his second penalty in over 5 minutes in period three.
Well, that's a sign of a young team. You're on the road, you come within one, you score two big goals to start the third period, and you overexert with that emotion and kind of get into penalty trouble here, which you don't want to be doing against RPI right now because they're hot on the power play.
Same unit that just put the puck in the net back out there. Agnew on goal, save, rebound loose in front. It was knocked away from Gagneau before he could get there. Agnew low for Walsh. She's right by the slot. A shot deflected. Save, rebound, score! The power play cashes in again, and TJ Walsh has the hat trick. RPI, the lead is doubled. It's 6-3.
Well, he's just parked off the side, right to the left of the goaltender, Abrick, and he really didn't have anything he could do here. Rebound went right to him, and he was just too quick to put that puck in the net. He's got himself a three-goal night and a four-point night, because he's got an assist, too.
TJ Walsh, what a night here in Troy. Two power play markers. Two rebound markers, which is three rebound markers. He's got them, all of them on the rebound, which is very impressive and tells you the value of finding yourself right next to the net. You know your line mates are going to shoot. Sit there for that rebound, and it's right there, and Walsh has proven it three times. Mazzotti chips out to the center line. Here's Brackett, a two-on-one with Evans. Brackett for Evans, and the puck just wouldn't sit for the freshman looking for his second goal of the game. Brackett in there creating havoc. 6-3. Engineers over the Black Knights, and you talk about how costly the penalties are. Two goals in the first 3 minutes of the third period by Army to cut the lead to one, but then two penalties and two power play goals in succession. That took the momentum and the air right out of the sails out of Army, and they've been jumped on here by RPI as a move made by Mazzotti, the rest of his line going for a change. He puck protects on the backhand into the near corner. One hand pass back to Surdy on the point. Man's getting a show this evening. Mazzotti a one-timer on the pass from Surdy. It fluttered on him a tad and went up and off the end glass. Kept in at the line by Surdy. He'll flip it in on Abrick, who will hang on, and the whistle will blow before he's able to spray that puck out to Driscoll. So a stoppage and admittedly a deep breath for everybody in the building. 12:47 to go in the third. It is 6-3 RPI.
Well, you mentioned it was 4-1 to start the period. Then it was 4-3. Now you're looking at a 6-3 score on two power play goals. And you said it, penalty's been very costly for the Black Knights tonight.
A team that, again, as you mentioned right off the top there, Coach, the third youngest in the nation, beaten Flutters one on goal, had the screen he was looking for. Wasn't able to get it on net. Here is Laurie Surdy, who was part of the offense there. His point is being covered by Beaton. Here's Surdy on goal, up and above, and out of play. It hit the netting. So the shot from Surdy was unable to connect. But again, you mentioned it right after the second penalty that was just taken there by Garby. A young team here. The Engineer is also a young team and still finding their identity. But when you're the third youngest in the nation and you feel the pressure of a team like RPI when they're forechecking you, you're going to make mistakes like that. It's part of the growing process.
Yeah, no question. I mean, you're gonna go through those. You're better off learning them now, non-conference games, than games that are going to count in the standings.
A lot of speed. Here comes Baez. He'll shoot from above the top of the circles, and Jack Watson gets the applause from the crowd as he gloves that one down. Baez had a lot of speed through that neutral zone. A lot of speed in general. Already one goal for him. But Watson can handle ones from those range most times.
Oh, yeah, no question. As a matter of fact, I thought it was just a routine save, to be honest with you.
Got quite the applause. I think the speed might have caught some attention of the fans here, and there's a good crowd on hand here on a Saturday night in Troy, especially right in front of us here on the side behind the bench of the Engineers.
I just think it's a situation where the fans are back in the building and they're taking advantage of it.
Not to mention, and I will point this out, their team 3-0 coming into tonight. So there's some success in the early going. Again, before ECAC hockey plays, so you got to take everything with a grain of salt, but here comes Lee, sent on goal. Abrick able to knock it down. He finds his own rebound, and Heidemann was quick to try to find that loose puck. He gets a couple of shoves there from Wilson, who was back defending him. No love lost between those two as Heidemann was aggressive there trying to find that rebound.
Yeah, unlike last night, both guys would be going for penalties. One would be getting a slash, or one would be getting a roughing.
And we would be in the middle of breaking it down. Okay, was that one a penalty? Which we did quite a lot yesterday, but most penalties have been earned so far this evening. And we'll tell you as it happens either way. Herman in on the draw against Smith. The Engineers leading 20-17 in faceoffs through two periods of play, paced by Jacob Lee, who won 7 of 11 through the first 40 minutes. Knocked to the line and out to center. That's where Lucas Kanta finds it. Doshin plays below the goal. Kanta once more off the end boards, but knocked away on the defensive play there by McIsaac. Liebold out to center. Rory Herman makes a move. He gains the zone, looking for a trailer coming. Attempting to learn from some of the situations earlier in the game as Ardenaz lays the boom there on the far side boards. Klee chips it all the way out. He was trying to get it out of the zone. He sent it over the glass by accident, so the faceoff will come back in the defensive zone. But Ardenaz, you've seen him more on the offensive end in the early going as a freshman with this team, but not afraid to lay the shoulder there, Coach.
No, that was pretty routine for him. You've got him coming down the boards. All you got to do is take a real good angle on him, which as a defenseman playing as long as he has, certainly closed him off pretty well on a good angle.
Faceoff will be to the right of Watson. Herman in on the draw. It's won by Army straight through. But it went right between the two defenders that were both waiting for a crack at that puck. Klee chips it along. Here is Evans trying to catch the puck after it rode the dasher board. Mazzotti lays a big hit. That was Andrew Gilbert, who was able to get the puck out of harm's way, but took the hit in the process. A real commitment. We've talked about it for this Engineers team, finishing their hits for most of this one. Sent below the goal, Ardenaz lays the stick check, but it's stolen away, sent back to the point, covering there as Garby sends intentionally wide, was looking for the deflection and nearly got it in front there from McCoy. Stepping in is Farrell. He takes a hit, still looking for possession on his knees. He flips it low of the goal, backhand feed. Looking out in front, it was deflected away with the active stick there from Watson. There's a pile up in the near corner that has the intrigue of some of the fans. Sent to the point, shot coming, that one's blocked. Farrell's shot did not get all the way through. Ardenaz absorbs the hit coming there in front from Sacco, but he's able to make the pass. It's chipped along the end boards. It is fluttering its way down, but will not go for icing. A well-executed clear there for RPI. Here is Strom bunting it out to the center line. Beaton's able to steal. He brings it into the offensive end. Beaton shoots. Blocker save. Rebound up in front. Knocked away with the stick there by Abrick. Good chance there for Beaton. He had a player coming that was Booty, but he just had a little too much traffic. Here's a pass coming late. Backdoor feed. He was looking in front for Farrell. That wouldn't go. Itagaki, a backhand feed. All the way for Wilson. His shot deflected and up over the net. Itagaki once more on goal. Watson turns it aside. Strom kicks it out. It bounces its way over the defensive blue. Now here comes Booty. Booty in for Strom, but he was marked by the back-checking Wilson, so he was unable to find that puck.
Good couple of scoring opportunities there for Army.
They're not without their ability to move the puck. We've seen that in spades. And I tell you, Max Itagaki, the freshman out of Glenview, Illinois, he had the assist on the first goal of the game for Army. It was a power play marker right from that same right side. He's got quite the playmaking ability. He's going to be a pretty darn good player for Ryan Riley's group if he continues to develop. A hit laid there. The puck skitters through the crease and wide. That's where Lee finds it. Walsh pokes it ahead. Heideman hits the brakes, but he finds a trailer. Here comes Laurie Surdy. Scored a goal in yesterday's game. It was the game winner. He sends middle. Here's Walsh, was dropping for Heideman, who shoots, and a save. Goes up off the end glass and was sitting there, but no one was able to find it. It's taken back the other way through center. A pass too far ahead there for Joey Baez. We have a stoppage, a whistle, and an icing call. So the puck will head back into the offensive zone with 8:35 to go in period three.
And I think Heideman had himself a goal had he put that on net, because he clearly had beaten Abrick up top above the blocker.
Abrick was a little out of sorts there, and the puck had bounced around so much, I think he kind of lost track of it a little bit and was kind of just trying to get some part of himself on the puck. Been beaten six times to this point by the Engineers, matching their goal output from game one against Mercyhurst last Friday evening, to be specific. So why not go for the record? But in the meantime, the win is much more important. 8:34 to go here, third period. Faceoff won there by Herman, helped along by McIsaac. The shot coming from the point got deflected wide. Here is Herman, trying to avoid a defender. It's Firiolo who's marking him. Firiolo got a skate on that puck as he was trying to go back and forth to shake him. Now it is Ardanaz. He'll drop back for Agnew, who was waiting for him as that last line of defense. Herman over the line will spray it in deep. Firiolo tried to send it along the end boards. McIsaac was there to knock it down, but his pass is picked off. Agnew, a really nice play there with the stick to knock that down at the line. It ended up getting taken over the line and sent in deep, but he slowed it down at least. Agnew will drop for Leibold. The fourth line, at least if you look from a depth chart perspective, but they've had some good pressure in this one. Agnew has it knocked away. Here is Kanta. Look to the middle. Would not sit, and then Andrew Gilbert was unable to keep the line. He was on his backhand, but couldn't keep that puck from going over the blue. A shot there gets deflected up and out of play. The faceoff will remain in the defensive zone, and we'll tell you more about it when we return. 7:26 to go, third period here in Troy. It's been an exciting one, and the Engineers are doubling up the Black Knights of Army. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN+.
It's the most historic conference in college hockey. It's a battle night in and night out. ECAC Hockey, an iconic conference home to 12 of the most prestigious universities and programs in the world, and showcasing the best student athletes in the sport. Top-notch facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions. ECAC Hockey, there's no experience like it.
RPI Hockey is back. Contact the Houston Fieldhouse box office at 518-276-6262 or boxoffice@rpi.edu to watch your Engineers in action this season.
To go, third period here at the Houston Fieldhouse. A 6-3 lead for the homestanding Engineers of RPI over the Army Black Knights from the U.S. Military Academy. They have possession after winning the faceoff right after the television timeout, but a loose puck will end up on the stick of Jacob Lee. He tried to knock it ahead for Heideman, who was waiting, but was unable to do so. A turnover on the near side sees Karinen with possession. Mason Klee takes it out of harm's way. A flip through the middle was just a little out of the reach there of Jacob Lee, who had nothing but room to roam if he was able to find that puck. Could not do so. Instead, John Driscoll will backhand it to the center line, but it's picked off and sent the other way there by Walsh. He was over the center line successfully, so no icing, just a clear in the beginning of a line change. To the line, the pass was intended for Baez, but it was turned over on a nice play there by Beaton. Puck pops up in the air, goes in on Watson, who will clamp down and hang on and take a face-off in his own zone. Just around 6.5 minutes to go in period three.
Well, game of special teams. We've got 5 power play goals tonight. 3 by the Engineers, 2 by the Army Black Knights.
A welcome addition to the offense there, that power play insurance. The power play was 0 for 5 in yesterday's game against LIU, and even a 1-for-5 would have made a huge difference, but the ability to move the puck the way the Engineers have and specifically find rebounds, and that is a direct shout-out to TJ Walsh in your programs. That's a huge addition to the offense. It changes things dramatically for Dave Smith's group, who's looking to move to 4-0 on the season with a win. They are 6 minutes away from doing so, but a lot of work between then and now. to the line and backhanded through center. A bounce finds its way to the middle, and a backhand was sent through the crease. Nobody home, though. That one coming from Eric Fuss.
Yeah, he's got to take that right to the net. He had enough space there to go backhand, forehand, and maybe send it to the far side on Watson.
Agnew with the line is upended, but he's able to send the puck in deep. Apologies to the Huss family. That was Eric Huss, not Eric Fuss. So don't fuss. I found it. Here is Itagaki at the line. Hits the brakes, a backhand feed, but nobody home except for TJ Walsh for the Engineers. His backhand pass finds Smolinski, who leads the offense into the near corner. The defenseman in on the offense. Why not? Sent to Klee. Klee whipped on goal. Save made. Rebound in front. Walsh was upended. A penalty upcoming. It'll be Andrew Garbey who will go back to the box. He took the second of the two penalties that ended with a power play goal for the Engineers earlier in the period, and he will sit for two more as TJ Walsh was where else but looking for a rebound in front of the net.
So now if I'm Coach Smith, then you know the power play has been going pretty well, I might put out a different power play unit just to have them get some time.
Would you say the mysterious third power play unit?
Yes. Would this be it? It looks like it. Yes, it does.
This is the unit that previously had Ryan Mashey on it, who again is not in the lineup in tonight's game. We're not exactly sure why, but he came up a little bit slow from a hit that he took against the LIU Sharks yesterday, the assistant captain on Dave Smith's team. So Rory Herman is the one who is taking his spot on the point. We saw with the Engineers up by a goal yesterday, they elected to put Kyle Hallbauer on the point instead. And actually, I'm figuring it out on the fly that there may have been more of a reason for that than just defensive responsibility. Either way, a power play underway here for RPI. Whipped off the boards, but kept in there by Surdy with the glove. He'll have to go back and fight for the puck. He's able to avoid the attacking Karanen.
That's a good move by Coach Smith. You know, you don't never want to embarrass your opponent. They're up by three, less than 5 minutes left, and give some other guys an opportunity to get some power play time under their belt, experience-wise.
Turned over, two players falling to the ice. Now a chance that's able to be thwarted there by Hallbauer, so the pass was blocked, and now RPI comes back the other way. No worse for wear. Here's Evans. He shoots, blocked, loose in front again. Wilson blocked the first chance. The puck is covered up there by Abrick. A bit of a whiff of a pass, or just not a very smart one there in the defensive end, and Army almost took advantage.
He looked like he was wearing figure skates and he caught a pick there. He might have been kind of overexcited here to look at that save again. He might have been overexcited to, oh my goodness, I've got a puck, and it's just me and the goaltender.
I don't want to put words in any player's mouth, but I think you very well may be onto something. This is the third quote-unquote power play unit that's out here for Dave Smith right now. It's Ardanaz and Hallbauer on the point. Mazzotti, Evans, and that is Walsh, so they do have one member of that other unit, the Jacob Lee-led unit.
He's a junior, so I think he just caught an edge there, unfortunately.
Yeah, I tell you, you know, it's period 12 of 12 of hockey this weekend at the Houston Fieldhouse, so there may be a couple of spots that are less than ideal as the puck is sent in on Watson the length of the rink. Evans ahead for Mazzotti, who gets the puck to the backhand. He is quick to go forehand to backhand for a player of his size. We saw that in his debut in the scrimmage and exhibition weekend a couple weeks back. Partial 2-on-1 here if they can hurry. Lyle, a backdoor feed, and they score! The feed there from Lyle, and Michael Sacco was on the doorstep to put it by Watson, and with 3:21 to go, a shorthanded goal for the Army Black Knights, and well, we're not done quite yet.
Well, that was just real good execution by Army, catching a defenseman pinching, and Walsh got caught down low. I think he was supposed to be the high guy, but at any rate, just a nice tic-tac-toe play. And Lyle's got himself a goal.
Well, 3:21 to go. Still 5 seconds left on the power play, and it's Lee trying to do something with it, looking for a backdoor pass for Heidemann. It wouldn't go. Here's Smolinski. He sends it in front. It wouldn't sit for Austin Heidemann, who was parked on that back door. Now it's Brackett. Bit of a mixed bag line. So the power play is over. Not only do the Engineers not score, they give up one in the opposite direction. And now the Army Black Knights are within two. A high-scoring affair here in Troy. A shot by Heidemann gets blocked by Wilson. Surprise, surprise. He had five blocks through the first two periods alone, coming off of a seven-block weekend last weekend. Here is Baez. He's met with a stick check. Lee plays it up off the glass. That one will deflect and go out of play. So the goal coming from Michael Sacco, Ricky Lyle, and then Anthony Furiolo, the defenseman and one of the captains on this team, will get credit for the secondary assist. A shorthanded tally, and it's a two-goal game, Coach.
Yeah, I had said it was Lyle, but he was the one that made the feed to Sacco.
Timeout is taken by the Engineers here with 2:40 to go. I think Lyle was the same one who had nothing but space between him and Jack Watson a few moments before, so he's able to get his redemption in a certain sense. Quite the game that we have seen here as we have a moment to take a deep breath. You can only imagine, even though there's only 2:40 left in the third, there's still a lot of this story left to be written, but we haven't seen we did see against Mercyhurst, but you know, the offense for this team wasn't necessarily its strong suit a season ago, at least not overly consistently. Now you're seeing RPI in another shootout, and they're ahead in this one so far. So the offense, it's starting to come together here in the early going in the non-conference slate.
Yeah, they're simple concepts. They're putting the puck on the net, the goaltender's making a save, and you're putting in rebounds. I mean, offense is pretty simple when you have, you know, good puck support and you're getting shots on goal.
The offense in this period, please, no, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I don't want to make it sound like it's real easy to score goals.
Right.
But when you put yourself in a position where, you know, offensively you're supporting the puck, you're there for the rebounds, you'll get your fair share.
It's not, and I don't think anybody would think you're saying it's easy, but there is a formula for it.
Oh, definitely.
There's a tried and true formula, and a lot of it does come with finding those rebounds. So while we were in the timeout, Gavin Abrick made his way to the bench. So Brian Riley making the decision to go 6-5 here with 2:40 to go. His team trailing by two. They have the most recent goal coming via a shorthanded tally. So now they'll try to keep their momentum going. Knocked to the corner there on the play by Strom, who hasn't played a whole ton in this one, but he's out there in an important situation here with 2:40 left. Into the corner. It's stolen away. A backhand chip goes the length. This one's going to wobble its way towards the line and be waved off. No icing. Furiolo touched it up just as it got to the goal line, so it's waved off. Furiolo and Farrell, two defensemen and captains on this team, manning the back end for Brian Riley's group here in the late going. Puck would not sit there for the moment for Baez, but it's taken ahead by Furiolo. He's spilled to the ice in front of his own bench. Baez chips it around. Knocked along the far boards, gloved down there by Strom. He's able to knock it to the neutral zone. Booty chips ahead, just over the reach there of Beaton. He nearly had the puck on his stick for the empty net marker, but it went just a little out of his reach. Here is Surdy in his own end, no real rush. Tried to chip it over the defensive blue. This time he's able to do it successfully. This one will go the length of the rink, but we waved off once more. Furiolo tried to stretch the strides a bit to nurse an icing call out of the official Wormley, who was standing right by that blue line, unsuccessful in doing so. Minute 20 to go here in period three. Surdy around the end boards, sent to the line and out to center where it's met by Heidemann. He has the puck on his stick, an empty net in front of him to the backhand, and he scores! A hustle play by Austin Heidemann. He rings it off the far post and into the empty net. Grab that puck for Heidemann. His first goal as a member of the Engineers is one that should likely salt this one away here in Troy.
No question. They certainly have the puck for him. It is the first of his career here at RPI. albeit an empty netter, but they don't ask how, they ask how many.
And Eidemann's got goal number 7. That's a pretty good good saying to be throwing around here at this point there, Coach. 7-4 Engineers now, a minute to go. Sent to the point, Wilson keeps it in at the line, hits the brakes. Wilson on goal, deflected, missed the net wide. Lyle behind the cage. His pass intercepted there by Smolinski. Mazzotti tried to get it out, unable to do so. This one's knocked out to center on the play there by Agnew. Wilson will go back and retreat. 40 seconds to go. Sent all the way down, the hand in the air of Watson. That signifies the icing that's later called. So the faceoff will head back into the offensive end. Austin Heidemann, the transfer from Mercyhurst, who made his regular season debut last weekend against his former team, left Mercyhurst one of their leading scorers from a season ago, 27 points in 38 games on 12 goals. That was in the second of two seasons. The Engineers will make a line change here. They were missing a player. It was Liebold. Herman, Liebold, and Gagneau with Ardanaz and Smolinski on the point. Ardanaz will send it towards the net, kicked away into the near corner with under 30 seconds to go.
I wonder what Liebold was thinking sitting on the bench. I hope we didn't interrupt his nap.
That's an oh shoot, that's me kind of moment. He's still on the ice in pursuit. 12 seconds to go, deflected behind the net. Ardanaz advances ahead for Herman. Final 10 seconds here in Troy. The fans will get to their feet. It rolls in on Abrick, who will knock it back behind the net. And the Engineers of RPI win by a final score of 7-4 and a back-and-forth effort, to say the least. It wasn't pretty the entire way, but they led by as little as one goal here in the third period, but a duo of power play goals, a hat trick from TJ Walsh, and RPI has begun the season with 4 consecutive wins here in non-conference play. And Coach, the crowd had a lot to cheer about tonight, that is definitely for sure.
No question, and they're proud of that. You know, Army tried to make a game of it there early in the second period, but they just couldn't sustain that kind of pressure, ran into penalty trouble, and RPI was on their game as far as power play was concerned.
We look at how the Black Knights began their comeback. It was Brett Abdelnauer in front of the net, deflecting that one past, and the shot from Firiolo. That at the time made it 4-2. That goal less than a minute into period number 3. Coach, that made it 4-2, and then just a little under 2 minutes later, it was 4-3, just like that.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, they tried to make a game of it, and it was right after this goal, when they make it within one, that they started running into penalty trouble.
The penalty trouble, the sign of a team that, again, like we talked about, has a lot of youth on its roster, so probably a learning moment for a number of players. That goal coming from Jake Feltner. In front, it was 4-3, but then the power play got on the ice for the Engineers, and TJ Walsh did what he did best tonight.
Yes.
That meanwhile, though, was Smolinski that shot the puck from the point. Apologies.
One of 3 goals. Yes, that's Smolinski's. The top shelf. There's been a couple of RPI goals scored by defense like that, going, you know, top glove from the point.
This is the one we were alluding to. The third of the trio scored by TJ Walsh, the hat trick, all coming on rebounds. A lot that you can do when you're right next to the net grabbing those rebounds, Coach.
No question. He's in pretty tight. He's got a good angle on it. You know, the puck, put it this way, the puck was going to him tonight. The puck was finding him tonight.
The puck found Michael Sacco for a shorthanded marker on the pass from Ricky Lyle that made it a 6-3 game at the time. Gave a little bit of life to this Army team after they had given up a duo of goals on their own shorthanded, but then it was Austin Heidemann with the puck on his stick, and on the backhand, he salted this game away.
Yeah, and he was pretty excited. First goal as an Engineer.
A couple of firsts on the night. Smolinski, the freshman, scoring his first career goal. Heidemann, the first career goal with the Engineers, and RPI finishes up the weekend sweep of LIU and Army with a 7-4 win. Well, that's going to do it here from the Houston Fieldhouse for everybody working hard behind the scenes, and for my partner Dan Fridgen, Dan Ball saying good night here from the broadcast booth. And Troy, the final score for the final time, it was RPI 7 in Army 4. You've been watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN+.